There are moments in human history where silence speaks louder than any words. When the entire global scientific community stops talking at the same time, when telescopes that share thousands of images monthly go mute, we are not witnessing a technical failure. We are witnessing a decision. Just a few days after 3i Atlas swept past Mars, the loudest signal in a solar system isn't radio noise or a spectral line. It's silence. Not a scientific pause as instruments cool and teams catch their breath, but a synchronized quiet from every major space-faring nation at once. NASA points, plausibly, to a government shutdown that began 48 hours before the flyby, a bureaucratic tourniquet that constricted press rooms and websites just as the moment arrived. The European Space Agency says their observations are still being processed. China, whose Tianwen-1 orbiter has shared more than 14,000 Mars images since 2021, often within days, has said nothing at all. No communiques, no thumbnails, not even a placeholder sentence acknowledging the encounter. In an age defined by megapixels and immediate release, the absence itself is now the most remarkable data point on the board. Under normal circumstances, this would have been a planetary Olympics. Think about the lineup. NASA's Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter with a high-resolution camera capable of reading license plates on the Martian surface. Mars Express and the Trace Gas Orbiter. The UAE's Hope Probe. China's Tianwen-1. All in position, all ready to capture the closest look humanity has ever had at an interstellar visitor brushing a planetary neighborhood. A configuration like this won't repeat for centuries. By every historical precedent, we should be awash in images, mosaics, spectra, press releases, cutaways, each agency racing to be first to plant a flag in the data. Instead, the feed has become a void. And that void, like the black space between galaxies, demands interpretation. Let's separate the mundane from the meaningful. Yes, a US shutdown can freeze public-facing channels. I've lived through enough of them to know that science doesn't stop when websites do. Servers continue to hum. Spacecraft continue to downlink. Engineers keep working. Calibrations are performed. Timestamps logged. Raw packets tucked away on mirrored drives. What shuts down is the ritual of science. The press briefings, the social posts, the quick-turn image releases that translate telemetry into wonder for the rest of us. Bureaucracy can delay the story. It does not erase the plot. And that's where the rest of the world was supposed to step in. ESA is not bound to Washington's calendars. The UAE's hope has its own rhythm. And China, whose space program pairs engineering with theater, rarely misses a chance to contrast its cadence with America's stumbles. Tianwen-1 is not shy. It's a symbol, a political instrument as much as a scientific one. When rivals hesitate, it usually publishes. Not this time. The silence is global. And if you've spent a lifetime reading between the lines of data, you start to ask a physicist question. What hidden symmetry could enforce such synchronized behavior? Now, before we reach for the exotic, let's remind ourselves why 3i Atlas warranted this planetary choreography in the first place. Long before the Mars pass, the object authored a dossier of anomalies. Its carbon dioxide to water ratio comes in near 8 to 1. A chemistry more at home in the freezer aisles of the outermost protoplanetary disks than in the comets we know. Its spectrum teases nickel without the customary companionship of iron, an elemental asymmetry that doesn't sit comfortably with standard nucleosynthesis. Despite an evident coma, the trajectory refuses to show the telltale twitch of outgassing thrust. Gravity seems to hold it in an almost platonic obedience, as if the jets cancel with surgical symmetry, or the mass dwarfs our expectations. And that mass, up to orders of magnitude heavier than you'd infer from its brightness, would place it in a category all its own among interstellar transients. Add to this the way it threads the ecliptic, glancing improbably near Venus, Mars, and later Jupiter, a sequence whose combined chance has been estimated at fractions of a percent. And you begin to understand why serious scientists keep using the word anomalous with increasing frequency. Even the way it scatters sunlight, extreme negative polarization at small phase angles, isn't playing by the rules our comets learned. In response, colleagues have done what scientists do. They built models. Some groups ran Bayesian comparisons of natural versus artificial priors and came back with jaw-dropping odds ratios. These factors so lopsided they make one swallow hard. No one with tenure puts their signature on an alien conclusion. Professional caution is the air we breathe. But the mathematics doesn't blush. It simply tallies likelihoods. You can be skeptical of any single anomaly. You can argue calibration for the nickel line, geometry for the polarization, selection bias for the trajectory. But multiply 7 independent oddities and the space of just a weird comet thins out like the atmosphere at altitude, which brings us back to the silence. If NASA were the only quiet party, you could chalk it up to circumstance. If ESA were delaying, you could blame pipeline latency. When China goes quiet too, the vector changes. Because China's instincts are usually orthogonal to ours. When the United States can't speak, Beijing likes to perform. If they had captured an unremarkable dust ball tumbling past Mars, an image release would have been a masterstroke. Science, prestige, and a subtle jab at an American agency hamstrung by politics. The fact that they didn't suggest not an opportunity missed, but a calculation made. There are well-worn protocols for this sort of thing. Not the Hollywood first contact we dramatize, but the SETI-era playbooks written in calmer times. Verify, replicate, coordinate. No unilateral announcements before independent confirmation. Convene quietly. Agree on language. Release together or not at all. It's not a conspiracy. It's institutional risk management applied to a species-level question. Even if the evidence turns out to be natural and boring, you only get one chance to stage manage the world's first potential look at something that might not be boring at all. Could there be a prosaic explanation? Of course! Maybe high-rise, tuned for rock at 30 centimeters per pixel, simply ran up against the photon statistics of a faint fast target. Perhaps the Mars Express team is disentangling cosmic ray hits from streaks in a stack of long exposure frames. Calibration can be cruel. And anyone who's reduced deep space data knows that turning raw photons into a trustworthy picture is more surgery than slideshow. But we need more time usually comes with a teaser. An engineering image. A cropped postage stamp. A spectrum without public interpretation. Here we have none of that. What we do have, trickling through amateur circles, is radio chatter. Encrypted downlinks at the right bands, at the right times, consistent with active spacecraft returning something. Not a smoking gun, routine traffic, but synchronous with the windows you'd expect for a historic pass. This is why observers feel the hairs rise on the back of the neck. In science, silence is normally a sign of humility before data. In geopolitics, it is often choreography. The overlap is where we live now. If 5 spacecraft in different orbits, built by rival nations, all saw something that doesn't square with a natural class label, then the conversation indeed shifts from the astronomer's office to the diplomatic table. Not because telescopes panic, but because people do. And what would justify a pause of this scale? A fuzzy dot doesn't. A poorly exposed streak doesn't. But a sharp structure with right angles does. A rotation curve that disobeys inertia does. A controlled maneuver at perihelion would. Even a surface texture with periodicity, a tessellation that screams design rather than geology, would send 1,000 emails flashing draft only and do not forward, while lab directors call their counterparts at midnight. You don't fear the thing. You fear the consequences of mislabeling the thing in public. Civilization-level claims require civilization-level caution. There's a darker, smaller possibility too. Not concealment, but embarrassment. Perhaps the timing and geometry conspired against everyone. Maybe atmospheric dust on a tiny sensor and a deep space camera produced false positives. No one wants to explain on national television. But statistically, 5 independent teams don't all trip on the same shoelace the same night. And even if they did, embarrassment tends to leak in the form of hedged blog posts and defensive threats. We have none of those yet, only that quiet, deliberate stillness stretching from Washington to Paris to Beijing. Let's be clear about what the silence can and cannot mean. It cannot retroactively rewrite physics. The photons that left Atlas and struck those detectors did what they did. It cannot erase the ground-based record. The carbon dioxide-rich spectra, the odd polarization, The near-ecliptic threading, those remain. And it cannot last forever without eroding public trust. What it can do is buy time for cross-checks and the drafting of one narrative instead of five competing ones. That doesn't make the narrative true. It makes it survivable. Meanwhile, the object itself continues in regal indifference. It neither accelerates to reassure us nor obliges our curiosity with a flamboyant tale. It obeys gravity within measurement limits that would make celestial mechanics professors smile if the context weren't so unnerving. It recedes from Mars, heads toward a solar furnace it seems oddly prepared to endure, and will in December cross Earth's orbital neighborhood at a distance safe for the nervous system, but close enough for telescopes to drink in whatever it chooses to reveal. What are we to do in the meantime? The first task is intellectual hygiene. Resist the easy extremes. Not every unexplained spectrum is a transmitter, and not every blackout is a cover-up. The second is methodological. Keep measuring. Point the radio telescopes at the hydrogen line and listen. Push the polarimeters. Stack the frames. Compare the cadence of outgassing, however faint, to the precision of the track. The third is cultural. Prepare ourselves for the idea that discovery in the 21st century may not look like a triumphant press conference under a flag. It may look like this: a hesitation, a whisper between institutions, a shared decision to speak carefully into a world where information outruns comprehension. I've been asked whether this could be the moment we've imagined for 100 years, the moment when the night sky stops being a backdrop and becomes a mirror. My answer is the same one I give to first-year students staring at a chalkboard full of equations that describe worlds they'll never touch. We will know only as fast as the data allows, and the universe does not bend to our schedule. If what these spacecraft saw was ordinary, then the silence will dissolve into slides and citations. If it wasn't, then what comes next will be the most delicate sentence humanity has ever assembled. Until then, remember this. 3i Atlas has already accomplished something remarkable without emitting a single syllable. It has forced the most powerful agencies on Earth, agencies that compete on prestige, on cadence, on spectacle, into alignment. Not orbital, but human. A brief, unnatural truce governed not by treaties, but by the gravity of uncertainty. If that truce ends with a grainy, forgettable image, we will exhale and move on, a little wiser about how fragile our communications are. If it persists, the silence itself becomes data, a boundary condition on what the cameras saw. Out there, an object from another star crosses the cold between worlds. It does not care that we are watching or that we are waiting for someone to tell us what to think. It does not know about shutdowns or embargoes or base factors scribbled in the margins of draft papers. It only knows momentum and sunlight and the faint magnetic breath of a middle-aged star. We are the ones who have to decide what to do with the possibility that something can be both natural and new, both ordinary in its physics and extraordinary in its implications. History's most important discoveries often arrive not with a shout, but with a pause. We are living in that pause. And when it ends, the universe will be exactly what it was before. Vast, indifferent, beautiful. But our place inside it may have changed forever.